before we move on to other correlations, I would like to take some questions. I think before we take questions, Professor Arun wants to add something.
One question which was there in Moodle was, in the data handbook, there are multiple correlations. Which is the one that I use for a given problem? Okay, there is no unique answer for that. See, there might be families of correlation for flow over a flat plate, couple of them, three or four of them, somebody might have done for some fluid, etc., etc., etc. What you have to do is look at the range of conditions of applicability of that correlation. See if it is done, if it is valid for the range of properties that you are having, and then use it. And what should a good correlation is the one which should be valid for a wide range of fluids and overall, what you say, property values, etc. Now, if I do an experiment for with say R 1, 2, 3 or something and develop a correlation explicitly for that, I cannot use it for flow with water or anything like that. So, and please keep in mind that empirical correlations have a certain amount of uncertainty involved in them, caused by the experimental uncertainty also. Okay, so these correlations are valid with plus minus 20%, 15%, 10%, whatever it may be. So you get an answer with one particular correlation, another correlation is also equally valid, you get a slightly different answer, does not matter. Okay, so this is something we need to emphasize, and students will come and say this answer is wrong, that answer is correct. Both answers could be equally correct or equally wrong. Okay.
Erod, any questions? There is a question mark.
In case of transport of crude oil from one country to another country, the pipelines are taken underneath of the sea. In that case, there is a chance for the pipeline to go through the icebergs. So in that case, the thermal boundary layer, what happens to the thermal boundary layer? Because the pumping power will be high in case of if the thermal boundary layer is more. And sometimes there is a chance for blockage of the crude oil flow. So what is your suggestion?
Actually, the question asked by one of the participants is that the crude oil transportation from one country to the another country is generally taken through sea, and sometimes it goes through icebergs. That word I did not hear clearly, I hope it is icebergs. Basically, what professor wants to impress upon us is that it is going through lot of temperature gradients. So whether the crude oil is going to get affected, the movement of the crude oil is going to get affected. See, the answer I would think as like this. See, the boundary layer, see, there is going to be temperature gradient, no doubt about that, and instead of heating, it is cooling the oil. And in fact, like in semi infinite medium assumption, we had said that how below we should be taking. Yes, if the temperature freezes my oil, if it is below the freezing point, definitely nothing can be done. But I do not think it is going to be frozen.
In fact, sea water is usually warm at the base.
So, yeah, see, professor says that sea water is generally warm at the base. So, it is not going to freeze or solidify the oil which is there inside. That might be one of the reasons. Maybe we can just go back and check what would be the temperatures at the sea bed. So the point is, I do not think they would lay the pipes intentionally where the oil is going to get frozen. So that is the answer I would think. Temperature is generally greater than 4 degrees Celsius. So I do not think it is going to freeze my oil at all. The freezing point of the oil would be much lower. I hope I have answered your question, Professor.
So what happens to the thermal boundary layer and hydrodynamic boundary layer in such cases?
The question asked is, what happens to thermal boundary layer and the hydrodynamic boundary layer? Thermal boundary layer or the hydrodynamic boundary layer is like this. It's going to be like whatever conventional. Of course, this is little premature question, but still I would go ahead and answer this because now that we have been asked. So this is a pipe. So now Prandtl number of the oil, I would think it is much greater than 1. So that means delta is much greater than delta T. So thermal boundary layer thickness is very much lower than delta. So that means delta is thicker, that is, this is delta, and delta T is thinner. This is delta T. So of course, we have not introduced this concept because you asked me, so we are telling this. This is the hydrodynamic developing length, and this is hydrodynamic developing length, and this is thermal developing length. So, the thermal developing length in case of oil will be higher than that of developing length, the hydrodynamic developing length. But I do not think all this is of any importance, because my pipeline is much larger. Developing length if the is typically of the order of 100 times the pipe diameter, but my pipeline size is running to few kilometers. So, developing length concept has no relevance, much relevance, but Nusselt number and friction factor are as good as which are derived for any other Newtonian fluid. As long as we can assume crude oil as Newtonian.
In such cases, the pumping power will be extremely high, then there will not be any flow to take place, no?
So, question asked is, in such cases for high Prandtl number, pumping power will be very high. Yes, pumping power will be very high, because viscosity is very high. For pumping power, it does not know Cp and all, KCp it does not know. For friction factor, what is important is the viscosity. Viscosity is very high, pumping power will be very high. In fact, this is one of the cases where we say classic example laminar flow will exist. Usually the flow is not turbulent in pipeline supplies, it is laminar flow. Why? Because viscosity is very high. I need to give that kind of pumping power if I have to supply the oil. I cannot say that I cannot pump. It has to be pumped, it is laminar, and the pumping power will be significantly larger than that of water or air. Okay, professor?
Will there be any provision to heat the oil well below the firing point of the oil in order to make the flow easier?
See, I really do not know. The question is, will there be any provision to give peep below? I really do not know how exactly the crude oil pipes are kept. Whatever I am answering is based on fundamentals. I would request you, professor, now that you have asked so many questions, can you take this as a homework and answer this question over Moodle, how exactly crude oil pipes are supplied? If you do not answer, definitely we will put it across, but I would request you to, having taken your 3 questions, I think you can put the answer. I think it is fair enough to ask you to put the answer for this question on the Moodle yourself. I think, okay. Okay, Panvel.
Hello, Nusselt number equal to C, Re raised to M, Pr raised to N. These are the constants of correlation. So, what are the different methods to get it? What are the different methods to find out these constants?
Okay.
How to obtain this value of constants?
Yeah. See, one of the participants' question is that we said that nu equal to A, nu equal to C R e to the power of m and P R to the power of n. How do I get this C, m and n? Yeah, it is a very good question. Anyway, we are going to answer just little while from now. We have solved it for laminar flat plate case, but it is not always possible to get the closed form solutions. If I cannot get the closed form solutions with mathematics, for example, for turbulent flow, one would take the recourse of experiments. We would find the experiment, we would conduct experiments and say that through experiments, at least we know the functional form, how to represent the results. So, I will find C, M and N through experiments. C, M and N through experiments. Okay.
Chennai University, Chennai.
The turbulent shear stress is deducting from the total shear stress. How it is so?
See, one of the participants' question is, do we deduct the turbulent shear stress from the total stress? No, we do not deduct. See, as I have been saying since morning, we have laminar sublayer, and we have buffer layer, and we have turbulent boundary layer. I am not deducting. In the turbulent boundary layer, what is there is only minus rho u prime v prime bar as the laminar shear, as the turbulent shear stress. And in the buffer layer, both of this minus rho v prime bar and mu del u by del y, they are of the same order. Both are of the same order. Now, in the laminar sublayer, it is mu del u by del y. We are not deducting. In the laminar sublayer, for example, u prime is 0 and v prime is 0. So, there is no question of having rho u prime v prime bar. So, this is not there, this is 0. So, we are not deducting anything from anywhere. It is just whatever is measured is just being reported. Oh, okay. I think what Professor Arun says is that maybe your question is why is it negative sign? No, minus rho u prime v prime is actually positive. Okay, that's a good question. Always I used to forget this, and but I used to give this as a homework for students. But actually, it is not. It's like this. If u prime is generally, if it is positive, v prime is generally negative. Why? Because where does the energy come from? Wherever, if it is lost in one direction, it has to be compensated in the other direction. So, if u prime is positive, v prime is negative. So, minus, this minus is essentially to make this positive. If one is positive and the other is negative, means product is negative, minus of this product is again negative, sorry, product of all of this is positive. So, total thing is positive. So, we are not deducting, this minus sign is essentially to make it positive. Any other question?
Sir, what about moving plate, boundary, what about boundary layer for moving plate?
The question is by one of the participants, what will happen for a, if I have a flat plate, in addition to the velocity, if this is moving, no issue. The question here is always it is the relative velocity which generates the boundary layer. So, if it is moving, the velocity at the edge of the boundary layer will be equal to the velocity of the plate. But there is, as long as there is relative velocity between u infinity and the plate velocity, there is going to be boundary layer. That is what is their convective flow. In fact, we are going to deal with this when we come to internal flow, but we are not going to solve for moving plate, and this is essentially what we study in various convective flows. Point is, for moving plate also, boundary layer is going to be there, and that boundary layer depends on the relative velocity between the fluid velocity and the plate velocity.
I have a question regarding the energy equation which we derived in the morning. The left side of the energy equation is convection, and the right side contains the diffusion, the pressure work and the dissipation. So, is it appropriate to call the left side as convection, or should we be call it, should we be calling it as advection instead of convection?
Okay. One of the participants' question is that if we see the energy equation, in the energy equation we have this term, what we have called this as convection. This is conduction, pressure work and viscous dissipation. One of the participants question is, why don't we call this as advection rather than convection? But if you really see, it is a combination of both advection and convection. See why? Because, why I say convection? Because convection is nothing but conduction within the boundary layer. Del T by del Y and del T by del X I am taking within the thermal boundary layer. But why is it there? It is because of the convection velocities U and V. So, it is very difficult to differentiate both the advection and the convection component, or advection and conduction within the boundary layer. So, that is the reason why we usually call this as convection, knowing very well or in the back of our minds that it is the conduction within the thermal boundary layer. That is all the answer is for this. Okay? Baramati, any questions please?
Sir, my question is about the Eckert number. What is the limit for the velocity when you consider Eckert number above the certain velocity value?
Okay. See, the question is what in the Eckert number, now that we are anyway here only, in the Eckert number, what is the velocity limit above which we should consider or neglect Eckert number? Actually, it is there here itself. Eckert number equal to Eckert equal to V square divided by Cp into Ts minus T infinity. Now, of course, it depends on the fluid also, but if I assume that my fluid is air, Cp for fluid is 1050. So, for the Eckert to become 1, let us say, for Eckert to become 1, what should happen? One of you should help me. So, that is, if Eckert number is 1, V squared equal to 1050 into delta T. or I should have my delta T such that my temperature gradient should be such that my V squared should be of the order of delta T, or this number V squared and delta T should be such that my Eckert number should be around 1. When will that happen? When the velocity is very, very high, because I cannot write delta T just like that, because it depends on the velocity again. I cannot fix delta T and go on increasing V, or I cannot fix V and go on decreasing delta T. They are coupled. Based on my velocity, the temperature gradient is high. What they say is that if my velocity is supersonic or hypersonic, delta T is of the order of Ts itself, then perhaps then it becomes, matlab, that is, if the temperature increases so high by virtue of kinetic energy, that is almost all the kinetic energy is transformed into thermal energy. So that's what happened with Kalpana Chawla. Okay, its crash was essentially because one of the tile had gone up, come out the insulating material on the rocket had come out, and the temperature had picked up because of velocity. So that's why there was that crash or whatever accident had occurred. Okay.
Okay, my next question is, sir. One more question is there, sir. Is it a incompressible fluid is in ideal or it is in existence?
The question is incompressible flow ideal or existing? Incompressible flow. What is incompressible flow? That cannot be compressed. Are there fluids which cannot be compressed or very difficult to compress? Yes. Water is a incompressible flow, very difficult to compress water. Okay. So, if you take the velocity of sound in water, it is very high. It is in thousands actually. So, but if the velocity of sound in air is 330 meters per second, both are linked. So, point is, water can be assumed, or water can be considered, why assumed? It can be considered as incompressible flow. So, incompressible flow is not an ideal situation, but inviscid is an ideal situation. That means, there is no fluid which is thoroughly inviscid. So, this is an ideal situation, but this is not an ideal situation. Okay.
So one more question is there. I have not understood the statement, when Nusselt number is 1, heat transfer across the layer is only by conduction.
Okay, I think we will take this question let me answer this question. Now that this question, we had expected this question. The question asked is, Nusselt number equal to 1 means conduction is equal to convection. See, we need to understand conduction upon convection. See, we need to understand one thing. Here we have written HL by K. Actually, it is not conduction over the length L, or actually what is that we are equating? It is conduction within the boundary layer. Conduction is equated with the convection. So, what should I take here? Actually, I should take H delta T by K, but do I know delta T? Today only we derived for flow over a flat plate for Prandtl numbers less than 1, delta T is of the order of Re to the power of minus half and Pr to the power of minus 1 by 3, but for all situations, delta T is of the order of R e to the power of minus half and P r to the power of minus 1 by 3. That is, I cannot get this type of solution for all cases. For that cases, I do not know delta T. Delta T is unknown. So, we can definitely say this thing is right, only when I say H delta by K. In that form, only one has a meaning, that is, conduction within the thermal boundary layer is equal to convection. If I write HLC by K, that equal to 1 has no meaning actually. But I write HL by K because I do not know delta T. I give all correlations in terms of characteristic length. When I write in terms of characteristic length, HL by K equal to 1 need not mean that conduction is equal to convection. It is equal to 1 only when conduction within the thermal boundary layer is equal to conduction, convection. Okay. Any other questions?
Sir, one more question. In temperature gradient dt by dy at y is equal to 0, is this definition or this means is it exactly on the surface part or on the layer which is in no slip condition?
Okay. See, the, one of the questions is this minus k del t by del y is h equal to minus k del t by del y at y equal to 0, is this only on the first layer or subsequent layer? Now, let me answer this way. Del t by del y at y is equal to 0, is it not getting affected because of the velocity distribution, the temperature distribution within the thermal boundary layer? Yes, for argument's sake, we can say that it is conduction in the first layer. Why? Because there is velocity in the subsequent layers. But I think we can conveniently say that actually it is conduction within the thermal boundary layer. But this del t by del y is affected because of the velocity distribution and the temperature distribution within the thermal boundary layer.
How do we get the temperature distribution after the solution of the velocity distribution? So, U has been solved. If you go mathematically, continuity x y momentum equation solution gave you that u and v, which when you put in that energy equation, the u dt by dx plus v dt by dy equal to alpha d square t by dy squared, that gave you the temperature distribution. Okay. So, this both u and v have come from the velocity distribution which was obtained from the momentum and the continuity equation. Okay, so, k dt by dy is definitely affected by the velocity above the layer. So, I cannot have k dt by dy at y equal to 0 independent of what is happening above it. Okay, so, it is definitely affected.
Everything is interlinked. Okay. We have
to get. Sir, having two questions for you. One is, when we are talking about the Nusselt number is function of x star, Re and Prandtl number, is it a better idea that when x star is increasing that your Re is also increasing over the flat plate? And if you
okay, the question asked by one of the participants is that we said that nu equal to is a function of x star and Re and Pr. Is with the increase of x, is Re also increasing? Yes, if you take nu equal to, what is our relation? Point, let me take the relation because I do not remember, 0.332, yeah. So, that is 0.332 Re to the power of half Pr to the power of 1 by 3. Pr to the power of 1 by 3, nu x Re x. So, that means what is Re x? Rho u infinity x by mu. So, as x increases for a given fluid and for a given velocity, definitely Re x is increasing. Definitely Re x is increasing. So, there is no doubt about that Re x is increasing. What is the second question, please?
So, in case of the flat plate, suppose we are calculating, say if you are having a 1 meter length, if you are calculating the Re over the plate, say at different locations, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4. So, we need to calculate the x or Re based on the L.
Low.
The question asked is, question. As we move along the length, let us say for a flat plate of 1 meter, if I calculate x equal to 0.1, x equal to 0.2 and x equal to 0.3, x equal to 0.4, will I calculate Nusselt number at x equal to 0.1 on the basis of L equal to 1 meter or x equal to 0.1 meter?
right from the beginning, we have been talking about this local heat transfer coefficient and average value. This Reynolds number being affected by the length gives you a local value of the Nusselt number, local value of the heat transfer coefficient. So, at x is equal to 0.1, I am going to get the value of heat transfer coefficient at x equal to 0.1. X is equal to 0.4, it will be a different heat transfer coefficient based on the Reynolds number at that location. So, if I have this, this is a common textbook problems. If I have electronic chips which are being cooled by forced convection, the chip at the first chip from the leading edge versus the 10th chip versus the 100th chip. So, each of this, the heat transfer coefficient is going to be different. It is going to be decreasing with respect to increase in x, okay? And that quantity is a local quantity. Now, if we are asked to calculate what is the total heat dissipation from the plate or something, then it is over the entire length. That case, you will take an average H value, in which case your Reynolds number will be based on the length of the plate, not the local distance. Your Nusselt number will be based on the length of the plate, not the local Nusselt number. So, whatever is the subscript that you use for Nusselt number, x, that is the same as subscript that you use for Reynolds number. If that is x, this is x. If Reynolds number is L, this is L. One other word of caution, if you have a plate of 1 meter and there are 10 chips, the 10th chip which is at x is equal to L, Reynolds number local will be REL. But Nusselt number for that will still be a local because you want to calculate heat transfer at that location. It is again play with English only. At a given location, if you are asked, it is a local quantity. Over a given length, if you are asked, that is an average quantity. Okay. So, heat transfer at x equal to 1 meter means how much heat is lost at that location. Heat transfer over 1 meter length of the plate would mean what is the heat transfer over the full length of the plate. There you will use the H bar value, okay?
VNIT Nagpur.
Sir, what is the effect of pressure on thermophysical properties?
This is a good question. The question is, what is the effect of pressure on thermophysical properties? There is going to be effect of pressure, but the effect of temperature is more significant than effect of pressure. But definitely pressure is also going to have an effect. We cannot say that there is no effect of pressure. But for example, thermal conductivity, if we take thermal conductivity or viscosity for that matter, if we take, both of them are more affected by temperature rather than pressure. So, usually that is the reason in most of the textbooks also they do not list out the effect of pressure on thermophysical properties, because its influence on the thermophysical properties is significantly lower compared to that of temperature. Over to you. Amal Jyoti College.
Hello. Yes. Sir, we have actually three questions. One is that, sir, in the derivation of the energy equation, you haven't considered the heat generation term. So, why it is so? And second question is that suppose you are going to measure the velocity in case of a lamina, sorry, or in case of buffer layer, we are placing a hot air anemometer. So, will the anemometer affect anything to the flow conditions? So, will it cause a very serious problem to the flow condition? Now, third question is that why it is that the Reynolds transport theorem is called as a transport theorem?
Okay. First, let me list out question by question. One first question is, first question is why volumetric heat generation is not used. First question is why volumetric heat generation not considered in energy equation, number one, not considered in energy equation. And second question is, in the buffer layer, if I introduce hot air anemometer, will it affect velocity? That is the second question. And in Reynolds transport theorem, why is Reynolds transport theorem called as Reynolds transport theorem? Okay, let me take up randomly. In a buffer layer, yes, whenever you intrude a probe into a flow, definitely the probe is going to disturb the flow. That's why I said you scale up your plate, such that your velocity bound, that is the buffer layer thickness, is very large. So that is, if you take a huge plate, let us say of 1 meter and 2 meters wide, then you would perhaps get a boundary layer, let us say of 10 centimeter. Then in that 10 centimeter, if you introduce a probe of 3 mm, then the intrusion levels are lower. That is one way of looking at it. Otherwise, there are today non-intrusive way of measuring things, that is laser Doppler anemometer or particle image velocimetry. Particle image velocimetry. So these are non-intrusive. How does it work? In a non-intrusive, for example, particle image velocimetry, I am just going to hand wave, it is quite difficult to make you understand, but what is done is, it is a pulsed laser, that is one laser to the second laser, it is going to be, there is a time difference of nanosecond, that is 10 to the power of minus 9 seconds. So 10 to the power of minus 9 seconds delta t, I have a pulsed laser. Now, if I have introduced a particle and I have tracked this particle, let us say I take this particle and I take picture between 2 nanoseconds, that is sorry, between 1 nanosecond, and if I were to track this nanoparticle within 1 nanosecond, a distance delta x, same particle mind you, this is A and A, but this A is after time t. So, I have got delta x by delta t, I get velocity u. This is non-intrusive. So, it is, we are not introducing any probe or anything. So, people have measured with particle image velocimetry and laser Doppler anemometer, wherein which they are non-intrusive, and people have found that, in fact, when velocity distribution was figured out, they were all done with either Prandtl probe or hot wire anemometer. But later on, these universal velocity distribution has been confirmed even through non-intrusive measurement. One thing we should be able to appreciate is that any measurement is going to be having some uncertainty. No measurement is a perfect measurement. So, every measurement is going to have problem near wall. Nevertheless, people all over the world in different places have measured and find that universal velocity distribution, that is in the buffer layer, is what we have found. So, that is the answer for the second question. Third question, why is it called Reynolds transport theorem? See, whatever laws we have studied, for example, conservation of mass, mass of the system is conserved, that is system, system is not moving here. But what is happening, if I take my fan as my control volume, air is coming in and getting out. What am I tracking? I am tracking a fluid particle which is moving in and out of a control volume. So, whatever I apply to a control volume into which my fluid particle is going in and going out, so that is Reynolds transport theorem. Why transport? Because my fluid particle is getting transported. Why Reynolds? Maybe perhaps I do not know why, maybe Reynolds only has derived this, I do not know, but perhaps either he has derived or in his honor it has been named as Reynolds transport theorem.
One of the easiest or best examples of this is that if you have a balloon in which you are trying to blow and there is a leak, okay. So, your mass is coming into the control volume, the control volume is changing shape, and at the same time mass is leaving the control volume. So, this Reynolds transport theorem basically looks at this whole thing, now m in, m out, and the change of shape of the control volume, because you are transformed from a system to a control volume whose dimensions can also change. That is also there, okay.
Is that okay? I have left out another question, q dot not considered, okay. So, if q dot is there, that can be taken as a source term in the energy equation. See why, for example, in combustion, if there is combustion, there is net chemical energy release. We add that as a chemical energy release, that is a source term on the right hand side of our energy equation. So, that is how even volumetric heat generation also can be accounted. There is, we have not taken volumetric heat generation because we want to be as generic as possible, that is all. The same way we took the energy generation term in the heat diffusion equation. If you see here, okay, one important thing what I have missed out is, if we see the energy equation and if I put u equal to v equal to 0, what is that I get? I get the heat diffusion equation only. So, that is essentially the answer for your question to take the volumetric heat generation. Is that okay?
So, for Reynolds transport theorem, can we apply it to mass diffusion case, or is it only for fluids, or can we apply it to any larger areas, further areas?
Will you repeat, can you apply to?
This Reynolds transport equation, can we apply only to the fluid? Can we apply to fluid cases, heat generation cases, heat cases, or in any other cases? Or suppose there is a mass diffusion case, that is mass transfer cases also, can we apply these type of equations?
Okay. See, the question is, can we apply the Reynolds transport theorem for mass diffusion also? Yes. Reynolds transport theorem can be applied for mass diffusion also. So, if you are handling combustion, you have to keep track of each species. So, for each species, you are going to write Reynolds transport theorem only. That is again conservation of mass and conservation of momentum. So, Reynolds transport theorem can be applied for mass diffusion also. What we need to realize is that Reynolds transport theorem can be applied as long as my fluid, as long as my fluid particle is moving. So, what is that? I have to press whiteboard, nothing. Okay. So, let us start off with the tutorial problems. So, we will take up one problem. I know there will be a lot of questions today. I would encourage you to ask us as many questions as possible. So, we will solve less of problems, but more of questions today till 5:30. So, let us take up problem number 27. So, what is problem number 27 saying? So, I need to experimental measurements of the convection heat transfer coefficient for a square bar in cross flow. For a square bar in cross flow, you are able to write air is v, velocity v, and L is characteristic length, L is 0.5 meters. Okay. So, now in the first case, H1 bar equal to, remember bar means average heat transfer coefficient, 50 watts per meter squared Kelvin, and when V1 is 20 meters per second, and H2 bar equal to 40 watts per meter squared Kelvin, when V2 is 15 meters per second. Okay. I think it is natural, heat transfer coefficient has decreased with the decrease of velocity. Okay. Now, the question is, a Nusselt number is of this functional form, a nu bar equal to C R e to the power of m P R to the power of n. What will be the, where C, m and n are constants, without telling, we have been thinking that since morning, and we have been telling that since morning. What will be the convection heat transfer coefficient for a similar bar with L equal to 1 meter when V equal to 15 meters per second? That is the question asked. So, how do I go about this problem? First of all, what is that I need to find? That is, when V equal to 15 meters per second and L equal to 1 meter and bar is similar to this, there is no doubt about that. So, now assumptions. I think we do not have to write, we will just state steady state. By now we know steady state, and we are taking average heat transfer coefficient, that is nu bar or h bar, and properties are assumed to be constant. Now, for external forced convection, for external forced convection flow, REL equal to VL by nu, that is the first thing, nu is mu by rho. Okay. So, now what is that we are saying? h bar l by k equal to h bar l by k equal to c r e to the power of m p r to the power of n. So, h bar equal to k by l c r e l to the power of m p r to the power of n. We can, for now we will keep it like that, r e l to the power of m p r to the power of n. Now, h 1 bar by h 2 bar, let us take, we have two cases given, h 1 bar by h 2 bar, h 1 bar by h 2 bar equal to k by l 1, c we do not have to, c is constant for both, r e l 1 to the power of m p r to the power of n upon k by l 2 c r e l 2 to the power of m p r to the power of n. So, k f gets cancelled, c c gets cancelled, p r gets cancelled. So, I am getting l 2 by l 1 l 2 by l 1 into r e l to the power of r e l by r e l 1 upon r e l 2 to the power of m. So, what is h 1 bar given? H 1 bar is given to be 50 and l 2 equal to l 1, no? So, l 2 is equal to l 1, let us expand, h 1 bar is 50 by 40, h 1 bar is 50 upon 40 equal to l 2 l 1 is same. So, l 2 equal to l 1, they will get cancelled out, r e l 1 we can write v 1 by v 2, because viscosity is same for both the fluids. So, it will get cancelled out and L 1 equal to L 2. So, that is also getting cancelled out. So, we are left out with only V 1 by V 2. Okay. So, what do I get now? So, I get V 1 by M, I get, that is 20 by 15 to the power of M, that is M equal to 0.7825. M equal to 0.78. Yeah, this is how one can, if we know, if we somehow experimentally measure the heat transfer coefficient, we can get this power m. That is, I think this is we have not reached yet. Our question now asked is, what will be the value of, now we can write h bar equal to, okay, I think we will write what is h bar when v equal to 15 meters per second and l equal to 1 meter. Let us write this. So, that is, yeah, L equal to 1 meter per second, 0.5 kahin diya hai, 0.5 L 1, it is not there in the question, yeah, okay. So, now let us write h bar upon h 1, h bar b for velocity equal to v 15 meters per second. For 15 meters per second velocity equal to and L equal to 1 meter. So, h bar nu for velocity equal to 15 meters per second, L equal to 1 meter. So, h bar nu upon h 1 bar equal to k by L 1, k, okay, L 1, it is there, we can just take that functional form. L 1 by L, L 1 by L, L nu into R e nu upon R e L 1 to the power of m, which is 0.7825. So, now h bar nu equal to, what is h 1 bar? 50 into L 1 is 0.5. Where did I get this 0.5 from? See the question, in the question it is given as L equal to 0.5, this 50 is for 0.5 in the diagram in the problem, okay. So, R e nu is v l by v 1, v nu L nu upon P1 L1 to the power of M. So, now H nu equal to H nu equal to 50 into 0.5 by 1 into 15 into 1 upon 20 into 0.5 to the power of 0.7825. So, H bar is equal to 34.3. So, second part we are not doing, because the same procedure you can apply, all that is asked is length is different and velocity is different. So, answer is H bar equal to 59.06. So, we are not going to solve this second part, because it is the similar exercise. Question is, what the results, would the results be same if the side of the bar rather than its diagonal were used as the characteristic length? If the side of the bar is used as the characteristic length. No, only thing is that we can use side of the bar as the characteristic length, no issue. Only thing is that my constant would have changed. Otherwise, my constant would not have changed. That is all. That is all. C m n will be l, n is independent of the characteristic length. Why? Because n is Prandtl to the power of n, which is a fluid property. But C and M depend on the characteristic length. So, the way I choose the characteristic length, it will depend on the characteristic length. So, we will take another, we will start taking questions again back. So, we can go to maybe KK Wag, you have any questions?
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Why Reynolds number, critical Reynolds number is taken as 5 into 10 raised to 5? For this laminar flow over a flat plate, and why it was 2000 for a pipe.
See, the question asked is for flow over a flat plate, for flow over a flat plate, we are taking critical Reynolds number as 5 into 10 to the power of 5, but for 5 into 10 to the power of 5. But for pipe, RE pipe, we take as 2300. Why? Because these two are different. Why they appear? Because we have taken different characteristic lengths in both the cases. RE is equal to rho u infinity LC by mu. LC for flat plate, we have taken LC equal to characteristic length, which is the length of the flat plate. For the pipe, we generally take diameter. But what we should take, we had specified this in Nusselt number also, H delta T by K, that is what we told. Similarly, for Reynolds number also, we should take rho u infinity delta hydrodynamic boundary layer upon mu. If I take rho u infinity delta by mu, no matter what class of problem I choose, that is external flow, internal flow, natural convection, jet flow or any other flow you can think of, they are all going to be of the order of 20 to 30. So, because we are taking different characteristic lengths, not taking appropriate hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness, we get different critical Reynolds numbers. But why do we do this knowingly? Why? Because hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness is not known. What we know is the characteristic length, that is the engineering parameter, that is either the diameter or the flat plate length. That is the reason why we take flat plate length or the pipe diameter, because of which I get the critical Reynolds number different.
So, there is another question. This is related to why we are considering only the fluid properties in deciding the flow, whether it is a laminar or turbulent. Why not the surface properties?
The question asked is, for deciding whether the flow is laminar or turbulent or transitional, why we are taking only the fluid properties, why not the solid properties? Now, who is offering resistance for the flow to take place? Because of the fluid viscosity. It is not whether it flows on a copper plate or it flows on a stainless steel plate or it flows on an aluminum plate, who is creating resistance? It is not the solid property material by virtue of which it is being resisted, it is because of viscosity. If there is no viscosity, then my fluid would have simply slipped over the plate, whether it is stainless steel or whatever it is. Because of viscosity only, it is getting no slip condition we are coming across, because of which only we have hydrodynamic boundary layer or the thermal boundary layer, that is no slip and the no temperature jump condition. So, there is no bearing or there is no connection whatsoever between the solid properties and the boundary layer. Boundary layer is only because of the viscidity or the viscosity of the fluid.
Over to you. Sir, one more last question, sir. Yes, sir. It is not expected to have a hydrodynamic boundary layer, but the thermal boundary layer is quite expected. Is it expected for the heat transfer? Hydrodynamic boundary layer is not expected.
Okay.
Thermal boundary layer, whether it is desirable, sir, for heat transfer?
Okay. See, there are, the participant is asking me two questions, whether hydrodynamic boundary layer is expected or thermal boundary layer is expected. I do not know what do we mean by expected, but what I feel by the question is that when I say expected, we are not supposed to have the boundary layer there. That is, when I have a thermal boundary layer, I am not supposed to have the hydrodynamic boundary layer. That is not possible. It is expected, both are expected. Why? Because there is resistance for the flow and there is resistance for the heat transfer to take place. So, because of the conduction in the thermal boundary layer, there is del T by del Y, and because of the resistance offered by the flow, there is within the boundary layer, that is the hydrodynamic boundary layer, there is velocity gradient. Now, is thermal boundary layer a desirable thing? No, not at all a desirable thing, because that is the resistance. What is F for fluid dynamics? That is Nusselt number for heat transfer. What is delta for hydrodynamics? That is for fluid flow. That is delta T for heat transfer. So, both delta and delta T are expected, but are unwanted, but they are there, nothing can be done. So, we have to overcome them. Then the only way to overcome them is either to have a fan or a pump. So, that is why our pumping power, otherwise this pump should have never been invented if there were not to be any boundary layer, it would have been just going by slipping. They will just go by because of the slippage, it just by you give the head and they will just flow. Once you generate the flow, they will continue to flow. There is no question of any resistance or getting the flow stopped somewhere. This is because the resistance is there inherently for the heat transfer or for the fluid flow to take place. Boundary layers are unwanted, but they are there and they are going to limit us the amount of the heat transfer or amount of the fluid flow. Why today laptop or anything miniaturization is not possible? Let us come to application. Essentially because of thermal analysis, because we are not able to cool the chip, the heat fluxes are going up, but my chip temperature is expected to stay at 30 to 40 degrees Celsius, otherwise it is not going to behave the way it is designed to behave. The heat fluxes are going up, but my temperature is expected to be at 50 degrees Celsius. People generally take this example. If we take the sun's temperature, sun's heat fluxes are of the order of 50s or 100s kilowatts per meter square. What is the sun's temperature? 5500 Kelvin. But same amount of the heat fluxes we are expecting on my laptop, but what is the temperature I am expecting to maintain? It is 50 degrees Celsius, not an easy task. That is why we are not able to make my laptops as small as possible. That is why they are, the life of the laptop, for example, is much lower than that of desktop, because I am able to cool the desktop. Even why desktop also, if you don't put properly in an AC room, if you just put in an outside, its life gets affected because of cooling. Okay, MANIT Bhopal.
I have a question. How can we correlate the bondi layer thickness developed over the fin and the effect of this thickness of the layer on the distance between the two adjacent fin?
Okay.
Over, sir.
Okay, I think can we postpone this question? Why? Because we have not told the concept of developing flow. So, if we complete internal flows, we will be able to. The question asked is, if on the fins, how does the boundary layer start and stop, and in between fins, how does it grow? Actually, we have to understand the concept of developing flow. So, I think we will take up this question after we cover the internal flows. All that I can say is, if you know, if you are very good at internal flows, this is the answer. It is continuously developing flow. It is never a fully developed flow. But after some time, it may reach periodically fully developed flow. You will not be able to understand what I have told. You will understand after I complete internal flows. Any other question, please, quickly. See, generally, I just want to make one clarification. Morning, we had one question. We have not taken unsteady terms in the non-dimensionalization of both the momentum and the energy equation. Even if you take the non-dimensionalization, for example, del u by del t, if you take, so what will you get? U, instead of u, you will get u infinity u star, you get u infinity outside, del u star u infinity outside, and del by del t, for t you take it as t star equal to t upon l upon u infinity. So, you get u infinity squared by l. So, that is, yeah. So, if you see non-dimensionalization, that is del t by del t, if you will get rho cp u infinity by l. So, you are going to get del t star by del t star. So, you are not going to get any other new term. That is all I want to add here. See, you are going to get, you want to write, that is del t star rho cp del t by del t equal to rho cp del t infinity minus t s into del t star upon del t star, where t star is equal to t upon u infinity by l, no, l upon u infinity, characteristic length l upon u infinity. Yes, correct. L upon u infinity, it works out. L upon u infinity. Let me solve. Yeah. So l upon v. So now if I substitute this in the top for t star. So, into t star into l by v, that is in the denominator l upon v. So, I get this is equal to rho v c p upon l, rho v c p upon l t infinity minus t s del t star by del t star. We are dividing throughout by this term. So, what am I going to get? I am going to get del t star by del t star, nothing new. So, no new non-dimensional number is going to come either in the momentum equation or in the energy equation for unsteady flows as well. That's the point I wanted to. Professor Sevatkar had asked this question in the morning. I had not given such a convincing answer, but this is the convincing way to look at this. So, whether I take unsteady flows or steady flows, I am not going to get a new non-dimensional number, both in momentum and energy equation. Do you have anything to add? Salem.
Will thermal boundary layer separate like boundary layer separation in case of hydrodynamic boundary layer separation? Like boundary layer, hydrodynamic boundary layer separation, will thermal boundary layer also separate?
The question asked is, will thermal boundary layer separate like hydrodynamic boundary layer? Yes, if there is sudden obstruction, if I am asking it to go through ribs, if I just draw ribs, let us say I take flow over a flat plate with two ribs. So, here velocity boundary layer is separating and then I have again regrowth of the boundary layer. This is same thing is happening both for, not only for velocity boundary layer, but also for thermal boundary layer. So, thermal boundary layer also separates wherever velocity boundary layer separates. That is how I think we can look at it. Okay.
Sir, my question is that suppose there is a flow in a flat plate and there is a flow of that is gases flow over a flat plate have high velocity gases and temperature of the gases also high. Suppose we are injecting a nozzle through nozzle of water. What is the effect of that flow in that plate?
The question is there is a flat plate, over a flat plate high temperature gases are flowing. Now, all of a sudden or gradually I have injected water mist or just water over this. So, we are asking for two phase flow. What are we studying? We are studying single phase flow. So, when in a two phase flow, it is actually interaction between the gases and the liquid. So, that we are not covering in any of the fundamentals. So, but anyway, to answer the question, what is happening is then there is heat transfer between the gas and the plate and water and the plate and gas and water also. So, it is the interaction between the gas plate, water plate and gas water. So, it is not going to be an easy task to answer this question and there is no closed form answer for this. So, but then it is a two phase flow problem. All that I can say is it is a two phase flow problem wherein which I need to take the interfacial shear stresses and interfacial heat transfer coefficients also. So, if you are saying gas is very high, maybe my water will get evaporated also. So, I really do not know, and if my water and the plate temperature is very less, maybe my water will get condensed also. Sorry, yeah. So, either ways, whichever has got evaporated back again, it will get condensed. So, it is a very difficult task, it all depends on the numbers what I choose. So, it is essentially the sum and substance of this question is that it is two phase flow problem.
Sir, can we apply the NS equation over here? NS equation and then energy equations?
The question is, can I apply the energy equation over here? Yes, but I have to apply the energy equation separately for gas, separately for water and then couple them through interface. That is what I have been saying, interfacial shear stress. These two get connected through interfacial shear stress and interfacial heat transfer coefficients. That is what happens in casting, that is what happens in melting. So, wherever two phases are there, interfacial shear stresses and interfacial heat transfer coefficients come into picture. But energy equation, momentum equation, continuity equation separately for both the phases can be taken.